You know, and I just interviewed Akon. Now, I remember you had an interview a while back, and you said that America was never built for black people.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that?
I mean, it's just simple. We weren't. I mean, you got to understand, black people were shipped here. It ain't like they chose to be here. Trust me, hadn't they not been brought here, they wouldn't be here. They'd be in Africa right now, and this world probably be totally different as far as what happens. America probably wouldn't exist. The way I see it is, it hurts me and pains me a lot that, you know, African Americans constantly complain about how they're being treated in America and how the laws ain't fair and how it don't fit the minorities when they actually can always just go back home.
The world is a place for black people. But meaning that black people didn't choose to be in America. They were forced.
Well, we didn't choose to be under this system. First of all, there's a lot of evidence that is coming up recently that's showing that we was already here. That we are the fucking Indians.
I was reading to prepare for this interview. I was quite surprised to see you use the word Aborigines talking about African Americans.
You know, I've dealt with that issue. I've already, you know, talked publicly about that.
And my purpose here today is to say that I'm very sorry. And I apologize to anyone whose feelings were hurt by my comment.
I've made very, very clear I don't know where that comment comes from.
Well, from your subconscious.
Well, I guess.
Oh, you.
What's up, man? What's your nationality, bro?
This is my tribe right here.
I'm crazy.
But it's not Cuban, though. It's incorrect.
What is it?
It's Masachuk. It's a little different.
What
but it's Manasai. It's the same thing.
What you mean, like, but your people come from Cuba?
Nah.
Where your people come from?
Israel.
Israel? What part of Israel?
Israel that's here.
Manasseh. Okay, but what do they call your people on this side of the earth?
Massachusetts.
Massachusetts? That's a native tribe?
Massachusetts State named themselves after a tribe.
Okay. Yeah. I'm with you.
But this is how the tribe is pronounced.
Okay, Manasseh.
So Algonquin language is the same as Israel language,
as
the same
Hebrew
as Hebrew language.
Yes, sir.
My language is very similar to this.
Okay. So y'all,
it's interesting.
Y'all down here from Boston now?
From Maryland.
Right? Okay.
You got it. Yeah, it was just interesting to see that.
Yeah.
I saw it early. I was like, yo, that's crazy. It's got our tribe on this.
Yeah, that's beautiful. I've been looking into the Algonquin and this. What is that other tribe? What is the other tribe like in New York? It's Algonquin. What's right in New York, though?
Algonquin is still Shinnecock, but they're all Algonquin still.
But they're all a part
Algonquin
of the Algonquin.
Is a language.
There's only
one Algonquin tribe there in Canada.
But the language group is Algonquin.
But our nationalistic designation is called Titicket.
Okay.
So our designation is the way that we do our nationalistic stuff, like our nation status, it comes from the land base in which your home village is.
Okay.
So we have 198 different villages within Massachusetts, but my home village is Titicket.
Okay.
because my grandfather, who was the chief of the tribe, I serve as council chief now, but my grandfather, he served as council chief, and when he did, the national designation was Titicaca. So on the old documents that you can pull from the Vatican from the 1621, you can actually see there that it says Massachusetts country or Titicaca country, opposed to, you know, like a tribe. They don't, we didn't even use tribe. But Mattakeesett would be my race.
Okay.
I'm considered Mattakeesett as my race, but my national designation is Titicaca.
It's crazy because literally we were just talking about it before you walked over. I was talking about how they got over 900 different, what they would say, tribes, but every one of them got their federal recognition.
Yeah, they only got 565 federally acknowledged.
Acknowledged.
But there's thousands that are unacknowledged, and every single last one of you guys standing out here comes from one of those tribes too, that are unacknowledged by the feds, but acknowledged by the Creator. Which
okay,
is
but what you're saying is, basically, though, you're acknowledging that we all go back
absolutely
to Israel. That's
absolutely, saying. Absolutely. But everybody thinks Israel is somewhere else. That's also another problem.
What are you saying? Are you saying
this
Israel
is
Israel.
In
America?
This is Israel.
Why do you believe that this is Israel?
I'll tell you why I know that.
Okay.
Because 10,000 years ago, they found an ancient rock from my tribe, okay? And it was very prehistoric. It was about 10,000 years old. And the language on there is the same language as the Hebrew language.
Yeah.
But also, what's interesting about this rock is that the story is the story of the Jewish high holidays, but it's ours. And then they replicated the story of the Jewish high holidays off of our actual documentation on the rocks. The story's off the rocks.
I'm the only normal person left around here. Black Jew, a cane reed, and I'm half drunk. I'm a black Jew. I'm a black Jew.
The lost tribes of Israel were black.
I'll be honest with you. I don't like the colored. Seems to me they're always getting into some sort of trouble. I don't think much of Hebrews either.
He was the tribal king. That makes him the heir to the Hebrew nation.
Before thy God from the land of Egypt, thou shalt know no God but me.
Jesus.
If you're asking what our guy's agenda is, then maybe he's basing it on Wallace's manifesto. Create confusion. Thank you.
What is Aboriginal American history? And what is Hebrew / Israelite history? Can you have one without the other? If you answered yes, you are seriously mistaken. Some people watching this documentary are either religious Israelites who believe all Black Americans originate in Northeast Africa, or so-called woke Aboriginals who have absolutely nothing to do with Torah. My goal is that both of these groups will have some type of spark in their mental recollection that previously never ignited. We are not from Africa, and Aboriginal American history is in the Torah. And what most people don't perceive is the fact that the well-known passage of Torah, known as Deuteronomy 28, is specifically about the plight of the American Aborigines since the last several centuries. Before I start, I must bring forth two major points. Firstly, it would be completely asinine to believe that all 44 million blacks in America originate from Africa. It is a well-known fact that 95% of all slaves went to South America or the Caribbean, and only 5% of all slaves sent to the Western Hemisphere went to North America. Now get this, 47% went to the Caribbean. But the real shocker is, there are more blacks living in North America than all the Caribbean islands combined. And according to the 2017 census, the total U.S. black population is 44 million, and the total Caribbean population is also 44 million. But considering the fact that not all Caribbean people are quote-unquote black, we know that the black population of the islands are far less than 44 million. Now, how could this be if all black Americans were brought over? Simply because we weren't. We are the first of the land. Which brings me to my next point. No one who calls themselves an Aboriginal American should do so if you don't claim or believe in Torah or any form of Hebraic study. Allow me to briefly explain. The very term Aborigine is a Hebrew term, which means first to pass over or to pass through. A bar in Hebrew is the root of Eber, which is the root of the word Hebrew itself. It means to pass over. Now, Rishoni or Rishini means first. Therefore, Aborigine comes from Aborishoni, meaning the first to pass over. I'm sure that most of us are familiar with Deuteronomy 28 and Leviticus 26. Basically, it is one of the most significant covenants our God made with our ancestors. A promise to our ancestors that if we lived righteously and did His Torah, we'll be above all the nations of the earth in health, spirit, and wealth. What many people do not know is that at one point, our ancestors were above all the nations of the earth. We actually traded goods and knowledge with other people on the Eastern Hemisphere, especially Africa. We also traded cultural knowledge and even scrolls. But a big lie that is propagated today is that North American Aborigines did not have any written language. However, this is a huge myth that is only believed simply because North American Aborigines were the most displaced, enslaved, and culturally stripped people in the Americas. Aboriginal American institutions were burned or destroyed, and people who built them or taught in them were wiped out. Deuteronomy 28 is also a serious warning that if we did not do his Torah, we would be beneath all the nations of the earth, a race of captives, prisoners, prey, and a spoil. And the only way to break this curse would be to turn back to the laws of the Most High. This is the thesis of the chapter, Deuteronomy 28 and 43. The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. Because the people who are high in the earth today, the so-called white man that is above all the earth, at one point was the lowest people in the earth dwelling in the caves. And the people who are at the bottom of society today, the so-called Negroes, at one point were literally the highest people on the planet. And the minute we went down, they went up. And the minute our ancestors fell, the white man rose. Now, what most people don't realize about Deuteronomy 28 is the fact that it is an organized chapter broken down into several sections, seven to be exact. Disease, oppression, land ruination, theft, distribution, desperation, and confusion. All of these terribly gruesome and unfortunate events happened to our ancestors in the past and are still happening to us in present times. When you read Deuteronomy 28 with the idea of the true Holy Land being in the Americas, you will get a new understanding of the actual context of the chapter. The chapter talks about our land experiencing immense drought, turning into dust, our plants not growing, our olive trees not giving fruit to eat. Because as soon as we were cursed, our land has become cursed as well. You can look in the western area of the Americas where we originally lived and tell that that land has been through some serious damage, some serious deforestation and desertification. Not only that, but that area has a type of olive tree known as the desert olive tree, which at one point in history was used as food, but now it's not. The purplish black olives that grow from these trees have adapted to a desert climate and now do not produce as much oil. In 1452, Pope Nicholas V issued a papal bull known as Doom Diversus. He authorized Alfonso V of Portugal to conquer all Saracens and pagans and non-Christians and deliver them into the hands of perpetual servitude. But this would later be applied to those of the Americas after the Moorish rule of Iberia came to an end. After the end of the Battle of Granada in 1492, hundreds of conquistadors sprang from the coast of Iberia and penetrated the old New World, with Christopher Columbus being the first. Some historians will say that white Europeans could not imperialize the old world until Moorish rule in Spain came to an end, because the Spanish and Arabic Moors were the first to lay claim upon the Americas from Europe, hence the numerous Arabic merchants all throughout the Atlantic during that time. It is also a well-known fact that Columbus brought a Hebrew interpreter along with him by the name of Luis de Torres, because Columbus was expecting to find Israelites in the land. Not only that, but Columbus also stated that he was trying to capture the holy city of Zion in the Indies. You can read about this in the book Christopher Columbus and the Participation of the Jews by Meyer Kirsling. In an excerpt of this book, we read, "Of sources, statements, opinions, and prophecies on the subject of the recovery of God's holy city in Mount Zion, and on the discovery and evangelization of the islands of the Indies and all the other peoples and nations, to Ferdinand and Isabella Echeverria, our Spanish rulers. Only going to the Caribbean and the coast of Central America, never to find this city of Zion that he was longing for. However, he found islands full of melanated Taino, Arawak, and Carib Indians, who he called Los Indios, or the people of God.
But there, he and his men raped the woman and took nearly 1,000 people as captives and brought them to Spain and Portugal. And they were traded along the coast of the Mediterranean and North Africa. Some were even taken as far as the Silk Road to Asia Minor. In 1493, Pope Alexander signed Intercateria, which gave Spain and Portugal authority to every area west and south of the Cape Verde Islands. In 1494, these lands of Central and South America were officially divided into conquest borders by the Treaty of Tordesillas. Spanish adopted their own version of slavery called encomienda, where captured people of the Americas were now property of Spain. However, when South America was under conquest, the goal of the Spaniards shifted from finding Zion to finding El Dorado, or the City of Gold, which many conquistadors probably considered the same thing, as in many scriptures, Jerusalem is described as a city laden with gold. These greedy bastards first heard of El Dorado from the Incas of Peru. They told them that El Dorado was a land north in the mountains. They thought it was Colombia at first. When they went there, they found gold, but not a city of it. They were still unsatisfied, so they spread abroad Central and South America. By 1520, hundreds of conquistadors stormed the Americas in authorization of Spain and Portugal. In 1521, the Spaniards under Hernan Cortes laid siege to the Aztecs and then went to the Baja California Peninsula in search of El Dorado. And by Francisco Pizarro and his men, the Incan Empire was dismantled in 1532. However, to whom of which I will focus on the most, and one of the most ruthless conquistadors in history, was Hernando de Soto, who actually worked with Pizarro at the age of 15, and just like Cortez, he decided to go to North America in search of El Dorado. However, instead of the armpit of California, he decided to go to the belly of the Gulf. He sailed from Havana, Cuba, to southern Florida, and immediately had hell with the Aboriginals of the land. Him and 250 men with him had a rough time getting through the thick, swampy Florida Everglades, especially the nights on horseback. But an immediate battle broke out between him and the black Florida Aboriginals upon contact. 16 of his men and 2 of his horses died within the first conflict alone, but the fatality of the Indians were higher. The arrows of the Indians were no match for the 300 Spanish bloodhounds fed on human flesh that were loosed upon the Indians during each confrontation. They normally had the power to kill entire villages. This is one of the curses of desperation. Leviticus 26 and 22. I will also send wild beasts among you, which shall rob you of your children and destroy your cattle and make you few in number, and your highways shall be desolate. Deuteronomy 28 and 26, and thy carcass shall be meat unto all the fowls of the air and to all the beasts of the earth, and no man shall fray them away. The Florida Indians, who fought and managed to survive De Soto's dogs, fled north and east into other territories. Deuteronomy 28 and 25, Hayah shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies.
We got people that call themselves Pan-Africans. We have ADOS. We have Moors. We have Hebrew Israelites. Ain't nobody come together. Because everybody want to have a different background. You have 2 sets of people that came to this country. You had Africans that came from Africa by way of the Europeans bringing them. You have Negroes who came from Europe, from Scotland and Ireland and England and France and Spain. Negroes, they came here. for a new way of life. And then they go under the term African-American. So they fighting with the indigenous people who know their history here. They look like you and I. But they can feel that they're not indigenous because they have a different mindset. You got Jabari. Jabari has roots in the islands. People from the islands were shipped to the Americas. People from the Americas were shipped to the islands to get rid of them. Just like they did with the Haitians. Get rid of you to take your land. People from Jamaica, Trinidad, all those people sent up here. People from New England sent down there to the islands. Sent to Bermuda, Bahamas. Taking the property from them. Now those people still look just like you and I in those islands. But a lot of them came from this land. A lot of our people in this land went down there and a lot of their people came up here. But they were indigenous people. So no, we understand how history went. We're not buying that other continent theory. When the information that's written, when they was telling the truth because they had no reason to lie, when there was no racism back then, they couldn't even figure out what race they were. They just knew that they come from the same landmass. They wouldn't call themselves white back then. But then when you come here and you start taking land, you want to say because you own property, you white. So they start classifying Negroes as white who own property. Negroes being classified as white because they own property. Then they decide, well, that term ain't gonna go. We gotta separate ourselves from the brown-skinned people who own property versus the people of lighter complexion from Europe who own property. So that term kind of fade away. For the Negroes, the free people of color. Yeah, see how that history works? It evolves over time. Right now what's evolving is, you can see well, you know that Jesse Jackson came up with the term African-American in 88. Why is it that when you look at a book now that's online, that's been reposted, the term African-American is inserted in it in versus the free people of color? See, they don't change all the wording that says color or free people of color, and they insert the word African-American in it. They insert an African-American in everything today because they want you to think that you came from another continent. And if you know better, they're gonna catch your younger generation that's coming up when you dead and gone. They're going to see those terms and they're going to think, we was always called African-American. Look at that. It's in a book that's written in the 1700s because you failed to tell them the truth. Just like what happened with those statues. They lost the war and they put statues everywhere because you was fighting for civil rights versus human rights. And now all of a sudden you woke up today and you say, man, where all these statues come from? We need to get rid of those. They lied. Had to take a man getting murdered on television for you to wake up. You got white supremacists all over this country stockpiling guns, dedicating their whole rooms and their homes to guns, ammunition. You walking around trying to buy yourself some Jordans. They out there on the weekend going to the range, going in the woods, hunting, shooting, practicing daily. You don't even know how to shoot a gun. You thinking you supposed to hold a pistol like they did with in Boys in the Hood, turn it sideways and style with it. They holding it with two hands pointing straight at you. You're gonna learn. Miseducation. You have a lot of, you know, when James Baldwin said that while he was rooting for Gary Cooper, killing off the Indians, and he found out that the Indians were him, were you. You know, you have people in history have always told you in code or a hint, and you overlook it every time. Malcolm X said that you don't like to be called Aborigines. You don't like that term. Martin Luther King told you that the Negro is in exile in his own land. In exile in his own land, his homeland. Teaching the Europeans.
On his Rus and Kiev Rus. And it will connect, you know, throughout all these lands, whether they're talking Saxons, Saxonies, or Isaac's sons, the Stuarts, Lady Andrews, look at this beautiful queen, royals, man, the royals. But now you're just a nigga, the nigga, the naga in the hood. Now you're just a nigga, naga in the hood. But my naga, you are the royals. And no matter where we're digging in our investigation, we keep coming back to the same point. That you are the beginning. You are the tribes. You are the tribes. You are the lost tribes of Israel. And it still looks like you, the Hebrew Tau. We're about to get to Tau, cities of gold. Let's go. We just surfing the wave. So we got Frankish names, right? Franks and Rus is right. Theodori, Amari, on the death of his father, Makir Theodoric, in 765. AD. Now let's go back, because didn't we just, were we just in around 750 BCE? Talking about Makir? It took us through this whole thing with King Hoshea, right? With 749, 750. This whole thing connected with Samaria. Hold on, man, let me sip my tea, man. I had to re-up on my tea. You know? Alawa, man. Mama drop is feeling good, man. Everybody that loves their mama, man. You know what I'm saying? You know, just say a prayer for all the Amas, you know what I mean? All the Amas. All the Aqua. Sip my tea. Beautiful 5 a.m. Los Angeles, man. You know, Inglewood, California. You know what I'm saying? Alawa. So they're going to figure out where they want to put us in this timeline. Because, you know, you got this Frankish activity happening. In the 700s, you know, 900s, you know. We got King David through Makir, the nasty name, Jewish king of Sept, seven cities of gold. By Charlemagne, who's also David, 760 AD. Hmm. 775 AD, Nehemiah Theodorus reconquers, right? So he already had America. He just had to get it back for his particular tribe. And we keep saying, is this one the real Solomon? The real Solomon who has a fleet of trading vessels known as the Ships of Solomon, who's also known as Solomon the Builder or Sylvanus Toltecs, my noggin. Is this the war happening, you know? After the death of Solomon, the kingdom is divided according to the script. Now we factor in Kaleluz, which means promised land. And this is where they got the King Arthur, Camelot. It's Kaleluz, the promised land of where? America, man. The American Empire of Kaleluz. All right. So I'm gonna stop there for now. You know what we're getting at. We're just talking Makir. And here's the thing that Daniel Lowe left out. He had all this in the forbidden history. Matter of fact, man. Watch this, you know, trickery, man. You know, we surfing a wave today. We're talking Kalalus, right? This is the Forbidden Histories of America. Get the drive, man. Click the link below. Land of Kalalus is the land of Cibola. Cibola, we're talking the Zuni-Cibola complex. That's where, you know, New Mexico, Arizona. So they're saying that this Esteban was the first to enter this area. He gets killed for bringing weapons of death. Cibola is Shimbala, is Sheba, my nigga. Good love to the queens. I got the Sheba series. We're going to start with Princess Scotia. Let's go, man. Land of Kalalus is the land of this American Empire of Kalalus we were just talking about. Just talking about it. You see it on the maps at Cibola. So this ain't no play. Let's connect the dots. Let's connect the dots, man. Pomegranate, Rome, Pomegranata, ka. And this Totantinyak is also another city of gold. So that's one city of gold. Cibola is known as a city of gold. El Dorado, you know, all the way to Mount Roraima is known as the city of gold, my nigga. I mean, hey, we might as well go step into these cities of gold, man. You know what I mean? Especially when you're just talking Kalalus or Cibola. Now, what did this cat leave out, man? What did you leave out, Daniel Long? What did you leave out about Kalalus, which is also called the entire land of America? Let's get it bigger. What did you leave out? Because we know American history now, right? We know about Toltecs. But this Israel III is coming out of Makir's line. Goes into the Toltec lands of Mexico. Makir, right? Amerique, right? Just put an A at the end, you get what? Also known as Mixcoatl of the Toltec. So he's in the codexes, my naga. Makir is Mixcoatl of the Toltecs. Who's the grandfather of Tapu Zin, also known as Israel the Seventh, who is the priest of Quetzalcoatl or Joshua. The real Joshua. Right here in America. Check the timeline. Let's go. What did you leave out, Daniel Lowe? So this is how he ends this particular paragraph, and we're going to read the exact same paragraph, but he's not including one line at the end here. Let's see what it is. Legends of Ogier the Dane, son of Godfrey, Kadrad, Dune de Mayence, actually refer to Tuatha de Danann or Dunan, who were also known as Mananan or Maine of America. So Dan is Dunan, is Mananan, is Maine. And when I'm not just talking about East Coast Maine. The original Maine was right there in the Four Corners, just like the original Rhoda, like Rhode Island. Rhoda is right there in the Four Quarters. I'm talking about the remnant of the Rhodons, which is where you're getting the name Rodrigo or Rodriguez. This Rhoda title connects to the remnant of Israel, my nigga. Then they, you know, settled in northwest Spain. So now they got the Spanish talking about Rodriguez, my nigga. But this wasn't always a non-melanated affair. It was all about the melanin, my nigga, right? It was all about the more on more war. The Rodrigo El Cid, Tapu Zin's great-grandson. Also known as Lane Calvo or Lancelin. And ain't there some type of Amazon series on El Cid? Did you know El Cid is also where they get the Lancelot character for Camelot? But we're talking the real Lancelin of Calais Luz, not Camelot. Lancelin from Lancelot is Calais Luz from Camelot. You know what I'm saying? But they all are a part of the Davidic Exilarch family. Still Davids, my naga. Still Davids. Where did you leave out Daniel Lowe? I love the Daniel Lowe because he's done some great work. We got to fill in the pieces is all, you know. We got to take it from here, Daniel Lowe. We got to take it from here, man. So the legend of Ogier the Dane, right? Dunan, also known as Mane. The Irish legend of Regamon also allude to this family. So the Irish legend of Regamon is also connected to Israel, like Israelites. And remember, my care, Amerique, is also mixed culture of the Toltecs. Why do we call America America? Is it named after Mixcoatl of the Toltecs? Is America named after Mixcoatl of the Toltecs? But remember, he's reconquering the American Empire of Calais, which was ruled by Sylvanus Toltecs or Solomon the Builder. So Mixcoatl of the Toltecs, see, this Toltec title is still just applying to Makir. Even though Makir here is going to war with Sylvanus Toltecs, it appears to be a family struggle going on. And where's the real Solomon? And here they say Solomon's dad, Calais was founded. Calais was founded 1st century BC by Babylonian exilarchs. So these are the kings or the rulers of Israel, the Judah Davidic exilarchs, my nigga. You know what I'm saying? The Davids, known as Sylvanus Ogam or Sylvanus Brabo. Solomon the Second, Babylonian exilarch. Ruler of Sumeria, right? Sumer, also known as Sumer set in Britain, but skip the conjecture. Stop with the parentheses, Daniel Lowe. What are we saying? Ruler of Sumer? Sylvanus Brabo is the barbers. Remember, barber just means swan. We're talking swan boats. Wings, these swans. These ships are shaped like a swan, man. Sails like the wings of a beautiful gliding swan. We're talking the royal family, right? The royals, my nigga. The royals, my nigga. Let's put our history together in real time. So, they just talked about Regamon in the Forbidden Histories of America. Irish legend of Regamon allude to this family, the Sylvanus, the Toltecs, the Makirs. Sylvanus Brabo, is this King David? It's a title under David? Are we talking about another name for David under the Berber or Swan title? Because these swans are connected with the Swan Knights. And what do we know about the knights? Oh yeah, we know that the knights or the Templars or the knights, the original ones, can, guarding the secrets, my nigga. You know what I'm saying? We know that the Rus and the Franks formed the knights. The Rus and the Franks formed the knights. And we can connect these Swan Knights with the Rus and the Franks in real time. Especially if we're just talking Frankish names like my kid. America. Let's go. What did you leave out, Daniel Lowe? The Irish legend of Regamon also alluded to this family. What did Daniel Lowe leave out? Let's get it here. The The Irish legend of Regamon also alluded to this family. Now look at what we didn't read. Let's go. Dun de Mayans actually referred to Tuatha De Danann, right? Or Dunan, also known as Maninan. Now look at what we didn't read. The Irish legend of Regamon also alluded to this family. Now look at what we didn't read. Let's go. Dun de Mayans actually referred to Tuatha De Danann, right? Or Dunan, also known as Maninan or Maine of America. Uh-oh, boss. See over here, that's the end of the sentence. That's the end of the sentence, but not over here, boss. That's why you got to keep cross-referencing my noggin. Right? Maine of America is the end of the sentence over there, but let's keep reading, my noggin. Where the giant ogre heads of the Olmec are found. Ogre, Olmec, Ogier, like Shrek, who just wants to live, you know, in peace on his own spot, but keeps getting invaded, right? The ogre are the Olmec. Now, we got to make that clear before we watch Cities of Gold, because they got Olmec looking like some Ewok alien creatures. But no, those ogres, as they make fun of us, right? They keep giving us these creatures to make fun of us, right? But the ogre heads are the Olmec. And the whole movie Shrek is just teasing. You know, it's a derogatory, you know what I'm saying, slap in the face to the real Olmec. Because the giant ogre is the Olmec, my nigga. And this became Shrek. This became Shrek. This became, you know, a cartoon. But we about to watch a little cartoons ourselves, you know. This became the ogre, right? But the first ogre was only connected with the ogah. And the ogah is connected with Sylvanus Brabo. And Brabo is where they're getting barber or swan. So don't come. The real depiction of Esteban. Oh, he was an enslaved Moroccan. How is that possible, man? If this is Morocco, how is it possible? How are you enslaved? How do you believe this cover story when this is going on at the same time? What do you mean you're enslaved Moroccan by some white people at the same time period? The same time period where you got a black Roman emperor? The same time period, Managa? You trying to tell us this is the story y'all gonna run. The same time period where you got this. Where you got this. And you got this. You see the fez. You're telling us that you're in slavery and this is what has. So now it's just, woe is me. Look at this man. Does he look like a slave, my naga? Or does he look like he's more connected with this? So who are you? Well, it gets complicated, right? Misunderstandings. So they're saying that this Moor was the first contact with the native people. What's the definition of an American in 1828? We'll get to the cartoons. I know you came here to see. You have a great dismount in the cartoonage, man. But, you know, the con, right? So if there's already a con here, Native of America applied to the originals or the copper-colored Nagas found here by the Europeans. Found here by the Europeans. Found here by the Europeans. The first European emperor of the Inca is Holy Roman Charles V, Charles Quinto, 15th Inca emperor. Bang. Found here by the Europeans. found here by the Europeans. Holy Roman Emperor Charles V, Holy Roman Emperor Charles Quinto, subsequent first European Emperor of the Inca. European. So he's the first non-native to make contact with the actual natives by nature to this land. Would he also be considered a, I don't know. Would he also be considered a European? First European, first European, first European. But you natives were just found here by the Europeans. Then they took your titles. So the first Europeans to take your titles, these descendants, weren't white people. They were more. The Moors took your titles. But they say, oh, it's all Ham and Kush. We're all Moor. If that's the case, if we're all Moab in them, Psalms 83 Confederacy, then this Moor wouldn't be the first to make contact with the native people or the copper color races found here. Who's this then? Who's this? If it's your first contact here, who's the copper color Nagas already here? And why? Oh, why Esteban? Why was Esteban killed for bringing these weapons and decorations of death? If this was all already rocking with Morocco. Morocco, right? I'm talking Mustafa, right? Oh, we getting warmer, man. This is a major puzzle piece to the More and More War. Mustafa, as in Maury, is Estebanico or Little Steven. Esteban the Moor. He wanted to explore India Superior, right? Love Florida. Go to unexplored lands, but it's Morocco. What's unexplored? It's all black. It's just all black. He's the first non-native. He's the first great African man in America, man. The first great African or the first Moor. Copper color race is found here. Copper color race is found here. This is the first outsider. Who was rocking with this outsider? Who together were forming the Confederacy. Psalms 83. On the real originals. Copper originals found here by the Europeans. And you know what, man? This is the first European emperor who is Charles Quinto at the same damn time.
Spartans 300. Okay, I'm gonna go through some pages here that you're gonna see. You're gonna find out that the Spartans and those people were Israelites. This is by Frank Miller. You got to get the one by Frank Miller. Now, a lot of y'all know about this guy right here who played the Spartans. He played a good show. It was pretty good. But now we're going to see. This book that I got here, by the way, I bought this 4 years before the movie 300 even came out. And I was surprised at the images that he used in here. But I never put it together until the movie came out. So some more images of Leonidas. Right here, we're going to prove the Spartans were Israelites. They were black people, dark-skinned people, and they were of the 12 tribes. So being of the 12 tribes, some of them had straight hair, some of them had curly hair, some of them were light-skinned, dark-skinned, some of them might have been from Indian descent, North American Indian, Hispanic, because we were all in Atlanta at that time. Let's go through this book and see how Frank Miller drew the Spartans. And so why he drew them like this. As you see the braids right here of the Spartan warriors. You can see the L on the shield. All right? Look at this guy. Another Spartan warrior. Look, that's a black man right there. You see? Look at the guy got curly hair right there. Some had braids, some had twists, some had curly hair. Look at this right here. That's a brother right here. He could be a North American Indian. Hispanic, Latino. They was all together. Look at the L. We're going to go into what this L means later on. And who was this? Look up here. Sacred Sparta. Okay? It was also called Laconia. All right? So we're just going to go through a couple pages in this book. Here is, remember the story about the kid, Leonidas, when he was a young kid fighting the wolf. Notice he's a black man. See, they got him brown skin here. Right here, another picture of him as a child. This is in the graphic novel of the boy. Here's some more Spartan warriors here. Get a picture of that. That's clearly a black man. Here's your Spartan brother. Brown-skinned man, that could be Mexican, it could be a Brazilian, could be North American Indian, because those are the 12 tribes. They were all together. It could be a black gypsy. Look at this guy right here. That could be a West Indian, that could be a Haitian. This Spartan right here. Okay. This is out of the book 300. How come the movie wasn't done like this? Okay. Let's go through some more pictures here. All right. More black pictures. Skim through here. Black people, look at this. Look at this sister right here. Black folks. Clearly see their brown skin. Okay. Let's do some more brown skin pictures. Look at this right here. Picture that. Brown-skinned brothers. Look at this brother. He looked kind of Indian and Hispanic. These are Spartans, not white folks. Okay. Let's go through some more here. Notice you keep seeing this L pop up on the shield. We're going to go into what that means. Okay? Look at this right here. Get a picture of that. That's a black man right there. Look at that face. See? Mm-hmm. Now here's, remember this king? The Persian king? Darius? Now he was brown. He was all right. But now he's even blacker here in the movie. In the movie, he looked like he could be an Indian or something. You know, but this, the Persians were Indian-looking people, but some of them look like that. And it's showing you, he's showing us a black man. You see? He was a Persian king. Here you go over here. A black man. And he showed you this in the movie, though, that the Spartans were black people. But I'm going to show you, Frank Miller knew something. And what it is, the history shows that the Spartans were dark-skinned people. They weren't white people like they portrayed them. Here's a boy again. Notice his leg is brown. He's showing him brown. He's clearly showing that this wasn't no pale white boy how they show you in the movie. Okay? So now let's go into why Frank Miller drew these pictures as black people. And how come they're not white? He knew something. He had to make them white for the movie. But we know why that is, because it wouldn't have got out there if he did it like that. Because the common lie is that the Spartans were white people. So he had to go along with the lie. But he did slide it up in here, you know, this way for us who are seeking this knowledge. And through the Holy Bible is a book that we follow. You can't find this being in some of these religions you got on the earth. I ain't going to name them. But you can't go to any religion and find out what I'm about to show you now. Okay, let me find this page. Now look at this right here. This is in the Bible now. It is found in writing. This is 1 Maccabees 12, 20 and 21. Arius, king of the Lacedaemonians, to Onias, the high priest, greeting. It is found in writing that the Lacedaemonians and Jews are brethren, and that they are of the stock of Abraham. So now you're seeing, this is the Apocrypha, by the way. This is part of the Bible. You can find the Apocrypha was once written in the Bible when King James had it translated from the Hebrew to the Greek. They took it out during slavery, but this is part of the Bible. So speaking about Jonathan, the Maccabee Israelite, writing to his Lacedaemonian brothers, who are also Israelites. Now let's see who the Lacedaemonians are. This is the new annotated Oxford Bible with the Apocrypha, showing that this is how the Bible is written, with the Apocrypha in it, which gives you continuing stories of Ezra in here, continuing stories of Esther, continuing stories of Ecclesiasticus, as Ecclesiastes, the Maccabee stories, Judas. You're not going to find them in the Bible. You're going to find them in the Apocrypha, which also the word Apocrypha means hidden books. Now let's go to the same 1 Maccabees 12 and 20, and we're going in 20 and 21, and we're going to read how it's the same thing written in this Apocrypha here, but now this is an annotated one written with other names that mean the same thing. So it says, this is a copy of the letter that they sent to Onias. Judas and Onias sent this letter to King Arius of the Spartans, to the high priest Onias. Greetings. It has been found in writing concerning the Spartans and the Jews that they are brothers and are the family of Abraham. So see how it's saying the same thing, but it's saying Lacedaemonians here. You see? It has been found in writing that the Lacedaemonians and Jews are brethren and they have the stock of Abraham. It has been found that writing, which is the Bible, because the Spartans had the Bible, they read their records, concerning the Spartans and the Jews that they are brothers and are the family of Abraham. Why is that? Well, let's see what happened here. It's another book, Modern Times and Living Past by Elson. Very old book, 1941. The older the book you get, I bought this on the street too. This used to be a standard reading in Southside Junior High School library. How come they ain't teaching this in school no more? Because the schools are about dumbing down the children now. They don't want them to learn this stuff. And this is on page 78. The mystical founder of Sparta was Lacedaemon, whose wife's name was Sparta. So now you're seeing here, Lacedaemon was the founder of Sparta, or the land there, and his wife's name was Sparta. So they named the land after him and his wife. You see, that's what the Spartans were, a black man and a black woman. So now, because we see the Spartans in the book were black people, we're going to go more into it. So this book tells you where this came from. All right? So let's go on through the records. You're going to put it together yourself. This is an excerpt from Wikipedia, the free encyclopedia. You can get a line on this. You can go on a computer and look up Lacedaemon. Okay? You got that? Right. Just let you all just look at that. Now we're going to go to this excerpt, this guy. And this is in other books too, but this, I got this one quick. The Spartans used a Greek letter, lambda, displayed on their shields as identification for their people. Lambda, L, was used as the Spartans to represent Lacedaemon, the home state of their people. So that's why I told you to be aware of these pictures. Look at the L, representing Lacedaemon, their founder and ancient leader of the Spartans, named after his wife, Sparta. Thank you.
changed the names of Indian people in Southampton County.
Exactly.
Their race from Indian to Negro or colored.
No, it was referred to as colored. And basically all the tribes of Virginia in the early 1900s were referred to as colored, okay? Then after the 1924 Racial Integrity Act, everything that was in that colored bowl became Negro, mm-hmm. okay? And that's one of the reasons why in 1968 the Supreme Court overthrew that Racial Integrity Act and gave Native Americans the right, if they were born before July 1960, to come forward to the Bureau of Indian Affairs and correct those records that had been changed.
Infamous Trial Lee, Infamous Trial Lee, Infamous Trial Lee. Triple D Tech, bro, you ain't scared about the shit you be talking about. Fuck on that top and I'm weedy, talk about business. Deep but just started, I finished. They said that I'm black, bitch, I'm injured. Fuck your Thanksgiving, shoot at these races for Christmas. I ain't got no time for no limits. Bitch, I see murder, I'm there for my niggas. Master the peace with no jail times or pictures. Came back for my pyramids, free my Egyptians. Disrespect my cook, they ass in a pot. Stop right now, set Kajo up, I'm in rhyme. Know that they know they act like they forgot. Bitch, we ain't slaves with the children of yacht. Come together, they think that they better. They took out your cheddar, put rats in your camp. Erase your maps, infiltrate snaps. That's how long they bring her, act like they can't count. Run them out the block like Freddie Hines. Outclip, man.